Good evening, friends. Welcome, welcome. It's good to have you all here for this installment of Healthy Pastors, Healthy Families. Tonight, we're going to be talking about the topic of the fully human pastor. And as always, I'm delighted to have with me my friend and colleague in ministry, Roy Yankee. Roy, would you like to say hello to our friends tonight?
I would like to say hello to our friends. Hi, friends. It's good to see you tonight and good to be with you again.
Roy is the executive director of PIR Ministries, an important ministry partner of the EPC, and it's been a pleasure to partner together in this series to address a range of topics that are relevant to the overall health and well-being of our pastors and their families. Tonight, we are joined by two presenters, and I actually think this is a first in our series. We cover every single time zone. We've got Roy in the Eastern time zone. I'm here in Central in the Chicago area. We've got Mike Anderson, who I'll talk about in just a moment, in the Denver area, in Fort Collins, Colorado, and then Larry Hackman out in Port Orchard, Washington. And tonight we're going to begin with a presentation from Larry. Larry Hackman is a pastor at Kitsap House, which is an EPC church in Port Orchard, Washington. He also is a licensed marriage and family therapist on staff with Hopewell Ministries. And maybe, Larry, you can tell us a little bit about that. After Larry talks with us a bit, we are going to hear from Mike Anderson. Mike is also an EPC teaching elder and a licensed marriage and family therapist. And Mike serves as the chaplain for pastors in Presbytery of the West. So it's a privilege for us to have both of you on with us tonight. We're very much looking forward to what you have to say. And Larry, why don't you take it away for us?
All right. Thank you, Annie. I'll talk a little bit about Hopewell maybe after I'm done with the presentation, because I think it applies to a lot of what we're going to talk about here. But let me go ahead and kick off by sharing my screen. So theme tonight is a fully human pastor. And to kind of dive into this, I wanted to cover really three different areas. And these three different areas, admittedly, I am going to take a thimbleful out of really oceans of thought and understanding of these. So, but I hope it creates sort of a cohesive idea that helps us to advance our ministry and helps us understand ourselves as human beings. But those three areas primarily are, first of all, some biblical anthropology, understanding what the Bible says about who we are as human beings. Then I'm going to dive into attachment theory, and then a little bit of neurobiology, and kind of wrap all of it together and help us have a good picture of it. First of all, the question of what does it mean to be human? That's a big question, and kind of the classical answer for that we get from Descartes. He said cogito ergo sum. In 1637, he came up with that. And that era, that age was the Age of Enlightenment. And Descartes' thoughts on what it means to be human definitely informed a lot of society, a lot of how we do church today. As a matter of fact, I think church continues, especially Protestant church, evangelical church, continues to be greatly influenced by cogito ergo sum. You think about our seminary training. Most of us, if you're a pastor listening right now, you were trained in seminary, and seminary is all about in a kind of Enlightenment Cartesian way of thinking. Got your systematic theology, you got your Greek and your Hebrew. You're focusing on this idea of we are human beings because we think, we understand, we can logically process things. Our church services were focused around preaching as the focus. The sermon, the proposition of the day is the focus, because we have an idea of formation of who we become as human beings through our minds, through our thinking. So preaching becomes a big focus for us. And think about the process of formation in church history as catechism, questions and then answers, which again comes from a sort of a Cartesian, I think, therefore I am, view of what it means to be human. So I think, and hopefully this is decreasing less, becoming less and less prominent, but I do think that the church today, if we were to think about what does it mean to be human, a lot of us often defer or default to this idea of to be human is to think, to be human is to be rational. And I think there's a problem with that. I'm not even sure that this is what it means to be human. For one, if we look at a lot of the science or the evidence of what it means to be human, it's just simply not true. We are not primarily thinking as humans. We are probably primarily relational or emotional as human beings. So just to assume that rationality is first and foremost what it means to be human, I don't think is true in experience or in the evidence. But I also don't think it's true to scripture. I think that scripture has a different perception of a biblical anthropology, which I'm going to get into in a little bit. So we want to be true to scripture and we want to be true to experience when we think about what it means to be a human being. So I think this matters for a couple of different reasons. One, when we think about what it means to be a human being, it helps us to understand how we change. So in other words, it helps us to understand sanctification. When we address the issue of sin in our churches, a lot of times I think we might address it from a primarily rational or logical perspective. I often see, you know, when the latest church scandal comes out, I think a lot of people have this kind of idea. Doesn't that person know better? Don't they understand, you know, what the Bible says or what's right or what's wrong? And we come again from this perspective of human beings as primarily rational. So when we wrestle with sin, I think it helps for us to have a emotional relational conception of who we are as human beings. I think this is important for our churches and how we form cultures. If we form cultures around this kind of idea of propositions as a means of growth, if we understand, if we know more, we change, I think that creates a certain kind of culture that can be unhealthy. And again, might not address issues of sin well or even closeness or relationship. And all of that creates sort of this picture of how we do ministry that maybe isn't serving us as well as it used to. So the alternative that I would suggest for Descartes' proposition, cogito ergo sum, is I would say I belong, therefore I am. I'm not sold on that. I don't know if that's a direct replacement for Rene Descartes, and I definitely don't want to compete with him. But that's kind of the direction I think we can go in for that. So theology, a biblical anthropology. Of course, if we're going to have a biblical anthropology, we need to begin in Genesis chapter 1, and particularly with the Imago Dei, Genesis chapter 1, verse 27. Let us make man in our image. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Yeah, the Imago Dei, gosh, that's such a huge subject. And I would not claim to be an expert, but I at least want to propose a couple of things about what it means to be made in the image of God. One, we know that God is a Trinity. He is an inherently relational God, three in one. And so part of what it means to be made in the image of God has to involve his nature, his inherently relational nature. I think also when it says that he created us in his image, male and female, he creates us, right? So when he describes us as human beings, he describes us not as one, but as male and female. And already you have a hint of us as inherently relational creatures. But that doesn't stop there, I think. When you continue on in the Genesis account, Genesis 2, 18, throughout the Genesis account, it is good, it is good, it is good, it is good. And then Genesis 2, 18, it is not good that man should be alone. And I think that's remarkable for the way that it stands out. First time anything is not good in the Genesis account, it has to do with our relational nature, that man is not meant to be alone. And then you continue on to Genesis 2:24, and he describes marriage there. So therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. It's a description of leaving one web of relationships, become a part of another web of relationships. So if I were just kind of to sum maybe a theological, biblical anthropology of what it means to be human, I would say we are made to be purposely interdependent. That is how God designed us. He didn't make us to be isolated, to be solo. We are purposely interdependent, one with another and with God. I'm going to borrow from Cron Gibson here, because he likes to say that God has made us needy. And he kind of pokes at that a little bit, because we kind of squirm if we hear that we're needy. But I think that's inherent to who we are as human beings. We need other people to be fully human. And we especially need God. We are dependent on God. So God creates this kind of interdependent nature in us purposefully. So what this means is that we are not actually fully human when we are isolated. We feel that in our guts, in our bones. There's something about us that is lost if we are isolated and alone. And this also has to do with what things were like pre-fall, that the shalom pre-fall was a relational shalom. There was harmony with God, harmony with each other, harmony with creation, and even harmony with ourselves. And so again, there's this really inherent relational nature to who we are as human beings, purposely interdependent. I think we see this play out in the Gospels when we see Jesus, who we know is the perfect human being. There's the account and at the end of Passion Week where Jesus goes into the Garden of Gethsemane and he brings his disciples with him. And Jesus, as the perfect human, when he begins to wrestle with what is to come ahead, pulls out his Westminster and his ESV copy of the scriptures, and he begins to remind himself of the truth of God's sovereignty, and it calms his. No, that's not right. He didn't do that. He pulled with himself three of his closest disciples, people who he would count as friends or his closest friends, and he asked them to pray with him. So here he is as the perfect human being, living out who God has made him to be, as purposely independent, as a needy person, in the best way you could say that, right? And more importantly, he seeks out his Father. In essence, he says, "Father, I am distressed, but I trust you." And in this way, he is modeling for us what it means to be interdependent, what it means to be needy, so to speak, in a way that's free of shame, free of selfishness, free of insecurity, but fully human. So that's a very Cliff Notes version of a kind of a biblical anthropology of what it means to be fully human. And if we expect scripture to be true in that way, I think we would expect to see that play out in behavior, in psychology, and I think that's exactly what we see. And so I want to talk a little bit about attachment theory. And I'm beginning with this guy, John Bowlby, who is the man who began to develop the idea of attachment theory. When John Bowlby came onto the scene at the beginning of the 20th century, the dominant theory of psychological thought was Freudian, which basically Sigmund Freud would say, and I'm probably going to butcher this because I'm no Freudian expert, but mainly we are people who are driven with these internal drives, sexual urges, and what if there's any neediness in us, that's a pathology, right? Because we don't want to be interdependent. We want to be able to control these urges. So insight was key, right? So you can kind of see the roots of enlightenment or Cartesian philosophy, even in Freud there, that if we have the understanding, if we understand what's going on in our subconscious, we can control that and not have to be dependent on other people. That was kind of the dominant view in psychology when Bowlby came onto the field. And so as an example of what that might mean practically, back in that day, and I think I've even heard people say this would happen even more frequently, more recently, but if you were a parent and you had a child who required a stay in the hospital would ask you to leave your child at the hospital. However young they may have been, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, whatever age, they stayed at the hospital alone. And a psychologist witnessing the distress of a child who was staying at the hospital alone would say, well, they're just playing out their weird Oedipal urge, their, you know, that internal drive, whatever's going on there, and that's pathological, and they need to get over that, more or less. I'm, of course, butchering Freudian thought. But nonetheless, that was in practice what would happen. Kids would get left at the hospital, whatever distress that may cause them, and that was okay. So John Bowlby comes onto the scene, and he had a couple of personal experiences that expanded psychology into a different kind of area. One was when he was younger, he had a nanny that took care of him. And at a young age, that nanny left. And that was a very distressing experience for him. He wasn't close to his mother. He was close to this nanny. And so as he grew up and as he went into adulthood and into psychology as a field, he always had that experience in mind of the distress of that abandonment by his nanny. He began to work with a group of adolescents who were incarcerated or in treatment basically for being thieves. And what he noticed is that a large proportion of these kids had traumatic childhood experiences, and many of them had no contact with their mother or a mother figure when they were growing up. And he began to kind of ask questions about this and begin to think about human development in terms of this attachment to a parent figure. After World War II, the World Health Organization commissioned him to begin looking into orphanages and founding houses where kids were being kept, and to understand things like what we call failure to thrive, kids just dying for no apparent cause in orphanages. And again, attachment as a field began to expand. So he wrote this, that quote there is from him. He said, "What is believed to be essential for mental health is the infant and young child should experience a warm, intimate, and continuous relationship with his mother or permanent mother substitute in which both find satisfaction and enjoyment." And so that was kind of the beginning of this idea of attachment. And the roots of attachment, if you want to describe it essentially, is that we have this innate drive for connection. You might say that we are created for connection. And this is at a survival level. And if you think about a baby who is alone or left alone, are they likely to survive? Not at all, right? They're helpless, they're defenseless. And so even from a very early age, we are interdependent. We rely on somebody as a caretaker for our very life. And God has so wired us that we have this innate radar for this connection, because even as a baby, we know that our survival depends on that. Where do I get my food? Where do I get my shelter from? So we have this radar. We're looking to our caretakers to know, is this person for me? And this was what we would call a safe haven. Answering that question, is this person who is responsible for my well-being for me? Do they care for me? Can I trust them? And then from there, we create a secure base. In other words, is this a place I can keep coming back to? Is this a person I can keep coming back to for my security? And psychologists have discovered from observation is that the more secure a child feels in terms of that attachment figure, the more ironically they actually can explore their environment. So they know that they can always go back. They know that there's a place that they can feel secure, and they actually move further away because they can feel like they can leave and come back, right? So that's what the idea of a secure base is. And from there, we as human beings develop what we might call internal working models. These are views of the world based on this attachment. So if I have a secure base, if I know that someone is for me, that tells me that I am worthwhile, that I have some worth or some value. And it also means that this person is trustworthy, right? So we create internal working models of who we are as people and who our other people are in relation to us. And so all of that creates what we might call attachment styles. Mary Ainsworth, after Bowlby, she was one of his students, began to explore some of this attachment. She and some of her collaborators came up with what they call the strange situation experiment. It's really fun. If you want to look it up on YouTube, you can see videos of this in action. But basically, she would take a mom and her child, put them in a room with a bunch of toys, give them a few minutes for this kid to kind of get comfortable and begin exploring the space. And then a stranger would come in, usually another woman. And the stranger would sit next to the mom and just first ignore and then begin playing with the child. And after a few minutes of that, the mom would walk out of the room. And every single child in that situation is going to be distressed, typically, right? But what was important, first of all, with the stranger being in the room is identifying attachment, that attachment is exclusive. There's one or two people in a child's life who they find as attachment figures. But then when that mom came in the room, what happened after when the mom came in the room was really indicative or telling about attachment style. So first of all, a secure attachment, what the kid would do is go up to the mom, and then within a few moments, they would calm down, right? The presence of the mother as a secure base, as a safe haven, allowed that child to regulate, and then they would begin exploring their space again. If the child was insecure in an avoidant way, what happened was when the mom came back in, there might not actually be much of a reaction. And if they were avoidant, they might not even pay attention to the mom leaving. So what's happening there is that mom is probably not a reliable source of attachment. And that lack of reliability is so terrifying for a child that the way they cope is they begin to shut down and they begin to suppress that fear and that emotion and sort of numb it out. So the reaction of the mom coming in isn't a reattachment or a soothing, it's simply detachment or numbing. So that's avoidant. And then an anxious attachment, the mom comes in, the child would protest and wouldn't calm down, right? So that they that mom in that case was probably unreliable in a sort of unpredictable way. And so they're basically saying, hey, don't do this to me again. I don't know if you're going to do this to me again because you've done it to me before. So all these attachment styles, what's interesting is as a child grows up, they're so important to our development that they actually form the brain in particular ways, how we empathize, parts of our brain that form in that way, and they carry into adulthood. So all these attachment styles become a part of how we relate to not only our mother or our father or other attachment figures, but spouses, close friends, other important relationship to us begin to carry these same kind of marks of either security or insecurity. Why does this matter? Well, I kind of took this dive into this for one reason. One, because it kind of affirms or confirms a biblical anthropology. Again, if we are purposefully interdependent, we would expect this kind of neediness or this kind of interwoven way of development that we end up seeing, right? This is who God has made us. We are inherently in need of other people and of God. And to that end, this is why attachment matters, because as much as we attach to God, to parent figures, to spouses, we also attach to God. And our development as human beings dramatically impacts our view of God. And a lot of our experiences with a mother or a father or a mother figure changes how we relate to God. So those attachment styles I mentioned earlier, whether they're secure, insecure, avoidant, or anxious, those very much carry into our spiritual relationships and how we pray, how we read our Bible, how we interact with our church community are very much impacted by our attachment. But this also carries into, as I said earlier, our brain development and how our brains work. So neurobiology is another piece of the picture here. This is my brain, your brain, all of our brains. And what you see here is the amygdala, the hippocampus. And this illustration particularly demonstrates how it connects to our prefrontal cortex. So prefrontal cortex, that's the place where Descartes came up with cogito ergo sum, right? That's our logical processing. That's how we plan for the future. Self-control happens in our prefrontal cortex. But then you've got the amygdala. Yeah, that word, amygdala, there it is. So that's where emotional processing happens. That's where especially processing related to fear happens. And you'll notice where it is. It's right there next to the brainstem. And the important thing about seeing this and this kind of illustration of where these parts of our brain are is that the really logical, systematic theology parts of us that happen up here happen much slower in our brain. And our amygdala, which is right next to our brainstem, very quick responses. So emotions happen before logical thought happens. Functionally, behaviorally, that is what is true for us. So the example I like to use with clients when I'm kind of explaining this is if I see a bear, I don't think about that bear, right? I have a fear response. If a bear is coming towards me like that, I'm not thinking, oh, that's a bear. Logically, I know that if I extend my arms and make, you know, rawr sounds, that bear is going to stop and that kind of thing. No, what's happening is my amygdala kicks into gear right there next to my brainstem. And it says, run, right? Or freeze, or whatever that may be the case. So that way before I have any sort of conscious thought, my body is kicking into gear and my emotions are kicking into gear deep in that amygdala. Well, as it happens, where do you think attachment and attachment styles are located in the brain? Prefrontal cortex or amygdala? That's right. They're deep in your amygdala. They're really right there before you have a conscious thought. All those attachment styles and all those kind of things are embedded at the emotional core of our brain, and they impact our behavior before we even really think about it, right? And that's true not only for our relationships with people who are close to us, our spouse or parents, but also with God. So that really matters, right? So the way that we would think about this is what we might call implicit or explicit knowledge. I've also heard this called a fast track brain versus a slow track brain. But we have kind of a certain kinds of knowledge that we might call implicit. And this is usually relational knowledge, that internal working model. We would call it implicit. It's not at the forefront of our thoughts. It's sort of the subconscious, and it can drive us. And then there's explicit, right? This is where we process our memories, where we think about and plan, where we have self-control. Those, that kind of explicit knowledge, the Westminster Confession, all that kind of stuff, is slower and oftentimes not actually what is in control of our behavior. So attachment shapes automatic responses that happen at the deeper amygdala level of our brains. And that's true not only of, as I said, people, but also of our relationship with God. So what this makes me think of is Romans 7, right? That famous passage where Paul is saying, I do not understand my own actions. I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. That sounds an awful lot like the way our brains work with implicit knowledge versus explicit knowledge. Paul was saying that, right? He knows what's right. He knows what is true. And yet there's a deeper part of him that does the things that he hates. And that is exactly the way our brains work. Now, and what's really fascinating as you continue on into Romans 8, as Paul talks about the life of the Spirit, he uses what sounds a lot like secure attachment to kind of address that. And I love, of course, Romans 8:15, for you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear. You have received the spirit of adoption as sons by whom we cry, Abba, Father. In other words, we have a secure base. We have a safe haven in the Father. And of course, later in Romans 8, there is nothing that can separate us from the love of God. So when we begin to think about what it means to be human, I think we can fully address what it means to grow, to change, and to be shaped into God's image. And in the process of sanctification, it is not only through explicit knowledge, through things like the Westminster or the Catechism, which I don't think are not important or not at all helpful, but I think we need a fuller view as we grapple with what it means to be fully human, to recognize that there are these parts of us, implicit knowledge deep in our brains, that need to be redeemed. They need God's work in our lives. So if we are to think about a pathway towards sanctification, towards healing, it's not only through that explicit knowledge, it is also through that implicit knowledge, which means we need what I would call corrective emotional experiences. If we develop these internal working models or these kind of emotional perspectives on people through experiences, then the way to correct those or the way to change those are also through these corrective emotional experiences, which means it's not just, I can't just memorize scriptures. I can't just know something. A lot of times I need to change by experiencing something or something more experiential. So I'm going to give you a litany of a bunch of things. I'm going to run through these really quick. I get these from a particular book. I'm indebted to Todd Hall for a lot of this stuff that's about to come out here in The Connected Life. Great book. He deals with this idea of attachment as impacting our relationship with God. But here's a couple of things that he says. First of all, bringing what is implicit to the explicit realm of knowledge, right? So if there are these things that are driving us in terms of our attachment, taking the time to slowly unearth those and to bring them to the surface and make that connection between this part of our brain and this part of our brain so that we can begin to deal with it. So one of the ways that I often invite people to do this is through an imaginative exercise. And just to take a moment, close your eyes. And as you think of who God is and to kind of sort of anthropomologize God, to put a face to God, so to speak, and to imagine what he looks like on his face when he thinks of you. And to do that in a way that's gut level, right? To kind of get in touch with that implicit knowledge instead of a way that's intellectual or using explicit knowledge and seeing what comes up, right? Does your self-image of your perception of God, one of him disinterested? Is it one of him frowning? Or is it the in line with the Aaronic blessing, right? An image of God smiling upon you. So that's one place to begin, and to begin kind of gain some self-awareness, to explore one's story in terms of development. Getting into contemplative practices. And what this is, again, this is sort of an experiential way of encountering God through silence, through solitude, through methods of prayer that are inviting God's presence. So sometimes breath prayers or meditative prayers are ways of slowing down and opening yourself up to God's love. Meditative or contemplative reading with the heart, Lectio Divina is a way of doing this. So some contemplative practices can be corrective emotional experiences. Cultivating deep relationships. I don't need to speak too much about this. I feel like, and maybe I'm wrong, maybe it's just the circles I run in, but I feel like everybody knows by now that pastors are lonely and that making friendships is a big challenge for pastors, but it is incredibly important to find those relationships that you can be intimate, authentically oneself, finding value from other people besides your role as a pastor, engaging in meaningful dialogue. Of course, this requires you to be able to understand your own protective attachment tendencies in terms of insecure, because those insecure attachments can often push people away. So that can be defeating when you're a lonely pastor. And then practicing lament, acknowledging if there are wounds. So if you are insecurely attached, often lament or sorrow is something you don't want to touch. Right, regulating that pain is extremely overwhelming, or it takes you into a fear state and you numb. So part of moving into a secure attachment is dealing with pain, dealing with loss, and being able to process that well with God and with other people. So in our churches, much of the same applies that way too, except just at a sort of a macro level. We need to address sort of attachment at a systemic level and think about the culture of your church. Are people able to feel safe, authentically themselves? And why not? What's going on there? Is there an insecure attachment at a macro level where people are avoidant or anxious? And what's going on there? As pastors, we can help change culture by modeling vulnerability. So it allows people to see, if I feel safe enough to be vulnerable, you can be safe enough too, right? We can do contemplative practices together. Many of the ones I mentioned earlier, whether that's prayer or contemplative reading, silence can be done corporately. We can facilitate formation groups, not just small groups, the places where, as I said earlier, we feel intimate, authentic, valued by others. It's not just our primary relationship, but we can do this in our church, in groups, and of course, lament as a thing. So my story, this means a lot to me personally because my dad passed away when I was 11. And my mom was not emotionally available before that or after that. And so in terms of who I am as a person, and I developed quite a bit of insecure attachment in terms of avoidance. And much of my adult life was wrestling with that up to even today, right? And so this, a lot of my story has been an exploration of not just that thinking part of who I am, but that feeling part and how that's kept me from other people and from God and how that has impacted my ministry. So it's worth saying at the end of my presentation here that this isn't just an intellectual exercise for me, but this has meant a lot for me in terms of understanding what it means to be fully human as a pastor for other people and for myself and what that's meant for my ministry. So that's it. That's a lot. I just wanted to pause there and allow anybody to ask any questions, give any kind of thoughts or reflections on any of this, and then we'll move on to what Mike has to share. If I can find my mouse, there we go.
So we do want to invite you to feel free to ask any questions or throw it up in the chat and we can ask them. If you have those questions, you want to engage with Larry on this, so feel free.
Larry, I'll ask you.
Go
ahead, Lauren.
Go ahead, Lauren.
I just wanted to say how deeply helpful this is just to hear this explanation and hear attachment. So thank you so much. I think maybe one question might be, how do you handle the challenge of vulnerability as a pastor to people not be as open to hearing you say, talking about things that are hard? Feels like that would be a risk to maintain, like, maybe respect, but maybe like, they're really, I don't know. It feels like I'm aware of that vulnerability. That question even makes sense. How do you manage trying to lead in this way as you're aware of the risk that would be to people who are not open, are uncomfortable, and might diminish you in your pastoring as a result of this thing that we know is really good to give, but maybe is unfamiliar. Does that make sense?
Yes, totally. Yeah, you were cutting out a little bit, but I think I got the gist of what you're asking. Like, if I'm vulnerable as a pastor, there's a lot of environments where that puts me at a lot of risk for somebody taking advantage of that, or maybe they don't understand what I'm doing and they see that as a weakness. Yes. So vulnerability as a practice or as something you do, we naturally choose when we are vulnerable, right? And I'm not going to be vulnerable when I walk into the dentist office and, you know, right? So we're already selective about where we're vulnerable and rightly so, because it does put us at risk. So I think as pastors, that requires a level of judgment and a certain level of risk, right? And some people will respond poorly to a pastor's vulnerability for the reasons I just stated, right? They might say, oh, gosh, my pastor's supposed to be strong. My pastor's supposed to be someone who has all the answers. And here they're telling me that they're afraid or that they struggle with this besetting sin or whatever it may be, right? And then they don't know how to handle that. I think you're just going to run into that risk. At the same time, a lot of times it might be a little bit of culture forming before you get to that point, right? You might have to use a little bit of explicit knowledge before you start getting to that gut level stuff where you're saying, hey, this is what we are going for. This is why we should be vulnerable. This is what it means for our relationship to God. This is what the scripture says about it. You might kind of set a framework before you say, now that that's out there, this is me. This is who I am. This is what I'm struggling with, right? So there's a little bit of work you have to do that. So just, it's just a matter of discernment, depending on who you know's in the room. If you know someone's just going to pick this up and stab you with it, maybe you don't do it, right? Or you address that person one-on-one. So it's just, yeah, I think it's just a level of discerning about, okay, is this the appropriate moment where I can begin to model this kind of vulnerability? Good question.
Larry, this isn't a question, but just a reflection. When you were talking about the fact that we are, you know, created by God to be purposefully interdependent, and you were talking about babies, it reminded me of something I had read a long time ago about how human babies are in that helpless dependent phase far, far longer than animals. Like human babies, there's a much longer on-ramp to independence and being able to function on their own, and just imagining why the Lord designed us that way, and how, you know, for this crown of his creation, that he created us developmentally to need a much longer time that we're dependent on our caregivers. It's really interesting.
Yes, absolutely. And I've seen that too. And part of the thinking there is that that length of interdependence as we develop also is part of what creates, as human beings, these really intricate, complex social connections that we have. So I absolutely think that's part of God's design, that he created us needy and dependent in many different ways. Yeah.
So I made a note. I don't know if anybody else has a question or not, but can you explore just a minute, or is, I guess the question is, what's the relationship between the cognitive and the relational parts of growing in self-awareness? Because there seems to be two sides of that. And maybe you disagree, I don't know, but yeah.
Yeah, that's a good question. So one of the important things when we're kind of unearthing those deeper kind of implicit parts of us is actually to make them explicit. And in doing that, when we're able to voice and give, you know, even create a narrative of story, like for me to be able to say, my dad died when I was 11. And what that meant for me is that I would, you know, I remember as a 15-year-old telling somebody, I'm fine, when I cried once, maybe twice about that, right? That, me telling that right now is to make the link between my implicit memory and my explicit memory. And by doing that, I'm actually kind of reducing the power of what's going on deeper in my brain implicitly by making it explicit. I don't know if that answers your question, but there is a link between the cognitive and the emotional piece there, that they work in concert. And if we don't have sort of a cognitive handle on the emotional piece, then the emotional piece is at the wheel, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right, thanks.
Mm-hmm.
Larry, maybe a follow-up to Lauren's question about vulnerability. Could you say a little bit more about what's been recognizing, as you've named and recognized your, I guess, original attachment style, what's been most helpful and corrective to you as you've healed from that and developed, I guess, a more healthy and secure attachment style? What would, if you would?
Yes. Yeah. Therapy. Yeah. I had a great corrective emotional experience through therapy. That was important. Spiritual disciplines have been huge. So I mentioned solitude and silence, journaling. So journaling for me is a practice of bringing what is implicit to the explicit. By writing down what's going on in my week, I ask myself when I journal, what is the state of my soul? Trying to get in touch with my gut and what I'm really feeling or thinking about God in that moment, instead of, you know, what I know is true. So journaling is huge for me. Relationships, particularly my relationship with my wife, that's an important one, right? But part of what's unearthed a lot of my fears or negative perceptions of God has actually been through my relationship with my wife and exploring our dynamic and seeing how I can be avoidant or numb or withdrawing from her. I noticed that. And then I realized, oh no, I'm doing the same thing with God, right? And primarily where that shows up with me is in prayer. So I'm a professional prayer. I'm a pastor. I pray on Sunday morning like a champ. But in my own personal life, I've noticed patterns where it would feel strange or weird. And I realized I had an implicit view of God as withdrawn or uninterested in the daily parts of my life. So very intentional practices of prayer have been very important for me to kind of change that and have a corrective emotional experience. Well, Mike, I want to make sure you have time to share what you are going to share. So I think since you last asked the question, that's a good place to kind of hand over the reins to you and hear what you have to say about being fully human. You're muted.
As you've already seen, technology is not my best hand or strongest suit. So, but Larry, let me just say thank you for that presentation. That was well thought out and heartfelt as well. And thank you for those insights and that framework and kind of let me say this too. Knowing that we're all fully human, can we just all maybe take a minute break here to stand up and run around the room? We'll talk about numbing out. There's parts of me that have gone numb. So let's stand up and we'll come back in just 30 seconds or something, but just to stretch a little bit. Is that okay?
Good idea. I love
okay,
it.
Okay, yeah, yeah. Okay. Hopefully everybody's back. Again, thank you for that, Larry. That was great. I think we just close in prayer right now. I think we'd be good to go. You're seeing the proper presentation. You're not seeing all my notes.
That's right. You're good. You have mastered the technology, Mike.
I don't know about that. I guess you could say Larry, although he had some very practical ways to think through and play out and live out what he presented, maybe you could say he's given us a broader 10,000 foot view. I'm going to get maybe down and dirty a little bit more and ask for some more interaction, some personal reactions, and maybe some self-evaluation as we go. I'm wondering if any of you saw the little inventory that we made available beforehand and anybody took that. If not, it's still, I think it's available somewhere. Annie could probably get it to you. And it's measuring a number of things that we're going to talk about here in just a moment. So anyway, that's my general introduction. I went for the longest subtitle in PowerPoint history here to help clarify a little bit what we're going to talk about. Challenges and resources for surviving and thriving in pastoral ministry so that we don't experience burnout or compassion fatigue, but rather compassion and ministry satisfaction. And you know, it's an interesting tension that we have, isn't it, in our pastoral ministry. Here we're serving an infinite and immutable God, and yet we are very finite. We're very limited. And so part of what we need to do as ministers who are fully human is to recognize our limitations. If we're going to not only live healthily, but if we're going to minister healthily and honor our calling, we need to recognize those limitations. So let's continue with this. And I'm having a little trouble because everybody's picture's over my notes. So here's what happens when we don't recognize that we're fully human. And here's what the crisis can look like. And maybe you've seen some of these statistics before. Some of them are a bit dated, but a lot of people leaving the ministry on a regular basis. I mean, the numbers are somewhat staggering, right? And not only that, you know, people, part of what we feel is the pressure, especially after the pandemic, when so many people seemingly left, went online, and then haven't come back. The number of churches that are closing and projected to close in the future, that can feel a little overwhelming. We can feel a little discouraged. 80% of pastors say ministry is negatively affecting their families, experienced regular periods of distress, felt the work of church seemed futile. Almost half of pastors have dealt with depression at some point in their life, and maybe even a little bit higher than that, knowing many of the pastors that I work with in my own experience. 33 have seriously considered leaving the ministry. I would say that's probably even higher. At least we've thought about it. You know, there's those Monday mornings where we just think, I want to go be a barista or drive a bread truck or something, just to, because it just isn't, it's feeling overwhelming and not very satisfying. And then 1 in 5 pastors struggle with addiction, and commonly that's porn. It's because in part because that's that secret kind of getaway that people use when they're kind of come to the end of themselves. And 80% of spouses, 85% of pastors, another statistic that's not on here, but 80% of pastors, actually it's the other way around, 85% of spouses feel discouraged by being in the ministry. And Larry shared a book earlier, one that I found helpful lately. It's called Don't Blow Up Your Ministry. If you can see that, subtitle is Diffuse the Underlying Issues That Take Pastors Down. Right. So why is this happening? Why are we in a crisis, at least at times? Well, it could be something. I mean, there's a wide variety of things that play into this, but I'm going to hone in on a couple that lead to this personal crisis in many pastors' lives. And they are these two things: burnout. And burnout, simply defined, is the cost of working too much. And if anything, I mean, this can happen in other professions, but we know in ministry, you know, when is ministry done? You ever get to the place, okay, well, you know what? I think I've taken care of everything. Maybe something will come up tomorrow. No, there's always more work to do. And so that can, of course, weigh on us. And then compassion fatigue is the cost simply of caring too much. And most of us who are ministers have gotten into the ministry, at least in part, because we care. But we can care too much. In fact, just throw this in here. Sometimes as I talk with pastors, and people in general too, is that we can care more by caring less. Care more by caring less. Now that sounds counterintuitive, maybe even a little paradoxical, but sometimes we try to care too much. We try to maybe control too much, and we'll talk about that a little bit more as we go. And then, of course, these things combined, and these things combined in a way that many times some of the symptoms of this actually look like PTSD. And if you Google that at all after this talk, you'll see that some of those traits for PTSD are similar to many of the traits I'm going to talk about here that we see in burnout and compassion fatigue. So if you're wanting a surefire formula for compassion fatigue, here are some of the elements that can play into that. You're a caring, compassion, and empathetic person. You're in recurrent situations that bring out compassion, and you feel compelled to be involved in a part of it. And then finally, your outflow of compassion doesn't equal the input of being cared for personally. I just had a pastor say this, that they feel like all the care and attention, the output is far exceeding the input in their life. And this is where this can become trying to figure out what's going on. Are we, it's really compassion fatigue? Have I really been caring and working too hard? It's not like we can, like when we go for a physical and we get a sensor put on our finger or put the high blood pressure cuff on our arm. This is really hard to gauge, right? Is this just normal, my caring for people and feeling, you know, being empathetic with others? Or has it really gotten to the place where the weight of this, the cumulative effect of this is beyond what I can handle? And how do we know this? Well, let's take a look at a few other indicators and things and definitions that might help us understand and be part of my point here of this whole talk actually is that we'll be better prepared to kind of, in a sense, self-diagnose, to better be aware of what's going on in our lives, to perhaps invite others in, as Larry has said, pointed out the importance of that. What is this compassion fatigue? What is it actually, and what more does it look like? How does it affect us? So here's a little bit more clinical definition of it: a state of tension and preoccupation with individual or cumulative trauma from those we minister to and manifested in one or more ways. Re-experiencing, so we ruminate on this. I don't know if you've had this experience, but you're carrying a load, you're trying to relax, you're out on your bike, you're laying down for bed, and those thoughts keep popping up into your head. Some of that's normal. Some of that means that maybe we're ruminating a little bit too much. Avoidance, numbing of reminders of the event. So we might try the strategy of avoiding and not thinking about these things, but we have to do it in a very purposeful kind of way. And then a persistent hyper arousal. I've worked in a church setting for about 30 years. And early on, I realized that when I took a vacation, I needed to take probably about at least 2 weeks, because it was only after about 7 to 10 days that I started to feel normal again. And I didn't realize this, right? I didn't realize that my body was working so hard. My mind was working so hard. The different parts of my brain, as Larry said, working so hard that I'm at a state of arousal. And for many of us, that just becomes normal. I believe Eugene Peterson used to take 30 days every summer to get away, and maybe longer. And then he added, I think, some study leave to it. I think because he recognized this, that it's very easy to get on this track and it become normal. We don't realize that we're, in a sense, hyper arousal. So, and here's part of the problem too, is that we've come to maybe believe some things about what it means to be a minister that just don't serve us well, right? Well, like this person here, thinking they're kind of super person who can keep this rock from rolling on them and others. So maybe we believe some of these lies or some of these myths. I'm trained and therefore invulnerable, right? And Larry talked a little bit about vulnerability, how important that is. And if we deny our vulnerability, obviously we're in trouble. I've seen worse and handled it before, which might be true. But again, there can be this cumulative effect and we need to be aware of that. I'm ordained, therefore I'm not supposed to be, I am supposed to be able to handle this, right? Somehow we again forget our finiteness. Only God is actually ordained or extraordinary in this sense. If I just follow the protocols, I'll be okay. Hey, again, I've done this before. I just go through. I know what I need to do, prepare for a sermon, for a funeral, for whatever it may be, even for a wedding, and not recognize that those things are taking some life and energy out of us. I'm okay. I have to be. Who else is there to help? Right? And this is, it can seem that way, right? We fill all the voids. We don't allow, there's a saying, nature abhors a vacuum. And oftentimes we do too. We rush in, especially as helpers, as caregivers, to fill every vacuum. And we just can't do that. We just don't have that sort of strength. I have to be strong and show a good spiritual witness, right? Kind of back to the question earlier, you know, can I really be vulnerable? about my limitations. I can't do that. I just have to show, you know, that I'm strong. Again, referencing Eugene Peterson, Michael Card has a book, and in the foreword of that book, I think it's called The Sacred Something or Other. Again, I can't see my notes completely, so I can't remember what that was, but he talks about being at his mom's funeral and doing the funeral for his mom. In the middle of the funeral, he broke down and he cried maybe for a good 2 minutes. And I'm sure for many of the people that seemed like 2 hours. Right? Unfortunately, afterwards, somebody from his congregation came up to him and said, you know, how come he was such a poor witness? Doesn't he know these kind of gospel truths and this sort of thing? How could you be let yourself be so emotional when you know your mom's fine and in heaven? Those sorts of unfortunate responses from people who don't accept our limitations can reinforce these sort of myths. So here's a few more additional things that will help us identify when we've moved into this area of compassion fatigue and burnout. Recurrent thoughts, we can't put out of our minds. We already talked about that a little bit. Distraction, boredom, irritability. We'll say a little bit more about that in a moment. Feeling off balance. And just this heavy breaking heart from seeing so much and not being able to kind of get over that and feel hopeful and joyful instead. Full-blown compassion fatigue has the following symptoms. I won't read those all, but you can see where this can lead to some very serious mental health issues. And this last one here, some of these flight and false strategies, drastic escapes. You know, we know about the Ted Haggards and the Gordon McDonalds and other high profile leaders who have given into this pressure with unhealthy strategies. But that's not just the big church, right? I think sometimes I've been in smaller churches and larger churches. I think sometimes smaller churches, people expect to have more of you and more of your ear, and the pressure can get even greater. So here are some of the things. I won't go through all these, but here are some of the things. And I would just encourage you to take a look at this. I'm going to have 3 or 4 slides like this. Some of the ways that compassion fatigue and burnout can affect you. Maybe there's some that really catch your attention here. And you'll want to, you know, come back to at some point in time or develop a strategy for dealing with it. There's another way that we're impacted. I've highlighted a couple here because it seems like with many pastors, perfectionism can really play into this. You know, we're working for God, right? We're caring for His church. Why wouldn't we want it to be excellent? But then we take it to the place of perfectionism. We can really set ourselves up for disappointment emotionally, behaviorally, relationally, you know, disappointment. And, you know, how many of us have preached the perfect sermon or taught the perfect lesson or found the perfect church or done the perfect counseling session? None of us. And yet sometimes we hold that standard even unconsciously. So I think it's helpful to examine that tendency. And then for me, I know losing things. I know that I'm trying to move too fast. I've taken on too much. I'm working too hard when I can't find my keys or my glasses or my sunglasses or my hat or my wallet or I'm irritable. I think there was another slide had irritability. Just the other day, I went to put a hanger up and I missed the rod and missed it again. And I felt this irritability rise up in me. And I go, oh, wow, my emotional tank must be pretty low right now that little incident would create that sort of reaction in me. So be aware of those things. Here's a few more. Again, I highlighted a couple. Anger at God. You know, when things don't go our way, or the ministry's not going our way, right? Or we have a loss, or an elder reacts a certain way, or somebody who we thought in our church was a friend suddenly kind of stabs us in the back. And maybe we're not just angry at them, but we become angry at God. We're working so hard. We're trying so hard. We care so much. God, how come you're not, working things out? And where do we go with that then as a pastor, right? Talk about being vulnerable with others in our congregation. I'm not sure, this might be one of those areas where it'd be particularly hard for congregants to hear that their pastor is angry at God. Not too many people want to sit and listen to an angry pastor, although unfortunately some people do. And the pastor, some of us, don't realize just how angry we are. As Larry said, you know, we can kind of suppress some of these things and some of these emotions and not be in touch with them. But we need to find that safe place to even express some of these, some anger at God, and kind of along the lines of lamenting some things as well. And then the loneliness. Again, the book that I mentioned, Don't Blow Up Your Ministry, the research that McKenzie, that's his name, did, said that, and Larry again mentioned this, that loneliness is the number one place where pastors feel less content. They don't have the relationships that they need. And by the way, McKenzie, if you don't know this is in terms of a resource, he's the head counselor at Marble Retreat in Marble, Colorado. It's a place where you can go when compassion fatigue and burnout have come to stay. And let me say this in a nutshell, that the number one thing that we need to do for compassion fatigue and burnout is stop. I mean, it really comes down to when it gets this bad, where you're having these kind of symptoms, the only thing that we can really do is stop. And fortunately, there's a couple of retreat centers like the Marble Retreat Center. Some of you probably know of Quiet Waters in Parker, Colorado. They're sprinkled all over the nation. It's amazing how many there are, because this malady is so epidemic. If you'd like more information about those, I'd be glad to pass that along. And then here's how it can affect us professionally. Some of the things that we can see playing out. So what do we do with this? How do we get back to this place of wholeness, of remembering that you probably heard the phrase, hurt people, right? And if we're hurting people, if we're hurting ourselves from all that we've been exposed to, that all we've been trying to do, if our emotional bank account is getting close to bankruptcy, we're going to be hurting people. So how do we let Jesus reinvigorate? How do we let others come into our lives to reinvigorate? Well, here's a couple of things that I want to mention before we close up our time. This is an interesting quote, I think, that gets to some of this, what we're talking about. All human beings have their weaknesses, but not all of us realize them, come to grips with them, or offset their negative impact. As a group whose primary endeavor is interacting with other people, leaders must accomplish the paradoxical task of managing their darker sides. It sounds kind of, you know, contemporary psychology speak, but any idea who may have said that? Maybe some of you do. That came from Abraham Lincoln, right? So it's interesting that this long-standing need for us as people who really care, are in love with God, love people, we have to recognize that we do have our limits, that we do have our darker sides. We need to be honest with that. It starts with honesty and then continues with vulnerability. So here's a bit of a corrective I found helpful in this diagram. And this is from a Dr. Nellie Morton, who back in the 40s, she was a Presbyterian pastor and educator. And I don't know if this is when drawings of the Adam were first given to us, but obviously she took the picture of an atom with the electrons revolving around it, around the nucleus, and she came up with these different dimensions. And I think this is a way for us to counteract and to measure and to move forward and not just sit in our compassion fatigue and burnout, but to maybe formulate a plan in order to move forward. Now, some of this has changed. You notice what's missing on these dimensions. Larry probably noticed it right away, but there's no emotional dimension. And in the later reiterations and revisions of this, the emotion piece was added. some things were combined. I think play and physical were combined. Sexuality probably comes along there as well. Society and nature is now about being aware of your environment. But anyway, I think this is helpful. And as you look at that, and as you maybe take your own pulse on this compassion fatigue and burnout, and here I've listed them a bit differently. Hopefully, there we go. Just listed them next to Dr. Luke from chapter 2 of Luke, in reference to Jesus and how he grew, and maybe how we could also think about dimensions of wellness in our life, which interestingly, I think 3 of the 4 also mentioned about Samuel and 1 Samuel. But whatever list you might use or want to take your pulse on, I think it's helpful to ask, where might I be less well? Where do I need some shoring up? Where might I be in trouble? And by the way, if you don't know this on your computer, Command Shift 4, you can then take your cursor and take a picture of some of these things. I took a few pictures of Larry's diagrams there, so you can come back to later. But you can do that if you need some more time to explore this. But I think it's helpful to ask ourselves where, and maybe ask others as well, right? Or as we talk with our therapist or our spiritual director or our small group, to be vulnerable in this way and ask, where is it that maybe I'm coming up short? Where do I need to improve on? And then, so here's a little, I guess, synopsis as I kind of close out my time about some things that I think are important for us to remember to avoid these two maladies of burnout and compassion fatigue. And first of all, just admitting our finiteness. And here's a quote to reinforce that. What persons in ministry must learn is what therapists have been taught for years, namely that if balance, distance, a sense of one's own limits, and an appreciation of the absolute need for rest, good food, exercise, and leisure are not present, then burnout is not a potential danger. It is a certainty. And then just to reinforce a little bit of what Larry said earlier, we need others are just so important. And for many of us, some of us, I don't generalize too much. Some of us have gotten into ministry as a way to care for others, but as a way to perhaps distance ourselves. For many of us, we're more comfortable giving than we are receiving. And yet we want to think well of ourselves, and we think well of ourselves because, again, we're giving to others, but we haven't really learned to receive. And yet that is so, so critical. And I believe this is from Henry Nouwen. If you've read any of Henry, he's so good at speaking to our heart, being honest. But he says, pain suffered alone feels very different from pain suffered alongside another. Even when the pain stays, we know how great the difference if another draws close, if another shares with us in it. And of course, it's not just the horizontal dimension of being with others. It's the vertical dimension. And he goes on to say, this kind of comfort comes most fully and powerfully visible in the incarnation, wherein God comes into our midst, into our lives to remind us, I am with you at all times and in all places. I've been reading a very challenging book by Kierkegaard called Works of Love. And in that, he says the true lover sits with God and breathes in God and gets his sustenance for love from God and draws his strength from God. And, we obviously know that as ministers, we're probably telling others to do that very, very thing. But when do we set aside our devotional time, not our preparation time for teaching and preaching, but that time where we just really develop the intimacy of God and knowing him, again, not just intellectually, but knowing him in that full bodied kind of way. A couple more things as we finish. Another way of talking about this is, how do we develop personal resilience? Term I've come across lately called anti-fragility. And it's this idea that we don't want to shelter kids and we don't want to shelter ourselves from by being too fragile. I guess something they found out in the biosphere, that these trees that grew up there without any wind, they got so big and then they just fell over because there was nothing to move them around and develop a root system. Instead, we need to find a way to develop personal resilience. Scripture talks about it, of course, as being faithful and persevering. And the secular world refers to those, a lot of those traits, by talking about personal resilience. And some of that looks like being optimally functional. And this is where we take our authority, right? The authority that we have in our ministry, our giftedness, but we also live it out in a vulnerable way, in a way, again, that embraces our finiteness, right? And then we maintain sound mental health under adverse circumstances. In other words, things are going to be tough. C.S. Lewis talks about the law of undulation, right? Both with ourselves or with others and with, excuse me, with God, there are going to be ups and downs. And so despite those ups and downs, despite the whatever we might be running into, we work to maintain a sound mental health attitude. And then we rebound, right? We are going to be down. There are going to be seasons that are going to be tougher than others, but we know that we can come back from that. Here's four qualities of resilience that I'll share with you briefly. Just let you read those. Maybe they're somewhat common, but good to be reminded of that. One step that you could take that I've taken that I share with students sometimes that I teach with. And by the way, we do a week when we come to self-care and burnout and compassion fatigue. And I've been teaching this for many, many years, and I still need the reminder, because we're people that forget about our finiteness and our need to care for each other. One thing that I found helpful is developing a soul care training plan. And this is a way, again, of just being more intentional about caring for ourselves, filling that proverbial, emotional, spiritual bank account inside of us, filling it back up again. And, you know, grace doesn't allow us to earn, but grace is not opposed to effort. And these are some ways that I found helpful, is to develop, because we're rhythmic people, right? We need to realize that part of what we're working against here is if we work against our rhythm, if we don't take care of our rhythm to sleep, right, and eat, we need to understand that God has a rhythm, not just physically for us, but also emotionally and spiritually. And we need to get on track with his rhythm. And this is one way to do it. And it's divided into three areas. How do I love God? How do I love others? And how do I love myself? That self-care piece. And these are just some examples of things that you could do on a daily basis. I'm sure many of you do. Although, again, it's easy for me to get busy and push these things aside and think I don't need them. And I think I'm now to the point where if I don't do it on a daily basis, I am aware of it. I do feel it. On a weekly basis, hopefully we all have found our Sabbath day. Again, I'm not working in a church setting on Sundays. I now so look forward to Sundays, to Sabbath, right? It just feeds my soul. It's so good. So we all need to find that. And then just monthly and maybe even yearly things where, you know, we get away and get a little more intentional about retreats or vacations and so forth. So with that said, we've got just a few more minutes. Let me offer a benediction in two forms. One in the form of a quote, and then one in the form of a prayer, probably a familiar prayer that many of you are aware of. But the first is, we must learn to forgive the old self. If we don't, we will have little room for grace for anyone who is like us. God desires to become radically honest and self-reflective, for us to become that way, learning to grasp the light and darkness in our hearts. The goal in all of this is that we approach self-knowledge as a way to worship and love God more fully. It is an exercise in learning about the kind of God who loves people like us. It's a book called After Doubt by Svoboda. And again, just recognizing and accepting our finiteness. And then this prayer that's been around a long time, Serenity Prayer. This form says, O God and Heavenly Father, grant to us the serenity of mind to accept that which cannot be changed, courage to change that which can be changed, and wisdom to know the one from the other through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Another way of just saying, I am finite, Lord, you're infinite. Help me, be with me. Yeah. The end.
Thanks, Mike. Really appreciate it. We have time for a question. If someone has one that they'd like to ask before we wrap up completely.
I have one.
Sure, go there.
So Mike, a real big believer in embracing our limits, and part of what's been important for my family is practicing Sabbath. You mentioned Sabbath. I'm curious your thoughts on the tension that often feels a pastor in sometimes saying no, or you know, feeling like we're letting somebody down in understanding my limits, or what would you say towards having discernment about when to push or to sacrifice of time and when to say no and to embrace limits? What's helpful in discerning that tension?
Yeah, I think to begin with, Larry, and it's a great question. I think to begin with, we have to have some very hard and fast and firm boundaries, right? And that'll eliminate a lot of the wrestling, right? If people know, and people on our staff know, that so and so is just not going to be available on this particular time, and they can only see this many people for counseling. Yeah, you can only do so many hospital visits a week, and to be able to say, and I think most people do understand that because they have their limits as well. I think sometimes we're afraid of setting those limits, that people expectations are much higher than they are. But I think most people respect those kind of limits. So first of all, we need to have a calendar that serves us well and helps make those. And then there are those times, Larry, where we probably, you know, we need to think, we need to pray about it. We need to consider, is this the exception to the rule? But here's what I found, which most of us, we're much more prone to make exceptions to the rule than to stay hard and firm to our boundaries. And we're really, in the long run, we're really not doing, we're doing everyone a disservice, not only ourselves, but others, because we're going to become that worn out, burned out, angry, perhaps, minister. So,
it's sometimes we talk ourselves into the fact, going back to where you started, Larry, with neediness, that somehow our needs don't matter.
Yeah.
In contrast to the many needs that we have in our congregations to serve. And it's important that those in ministry understand, as a human being,
that's good, Roy.
Your needs matter. So, yeah. All right. Well, great. Thank you both of you, Larry and Mike, for sharing with us tonight and encouraging us to be more aware of what it means to be fully human. So I'm going to close us in prayer. Before I do, I want to make sure those of you who are watching now live and who are going to watch in recorded version, that our next one is coming, the next webinar is coming up October 29th. Cron Gibson, who is the executive director of Hopewell, is going to be talking with us about building a relationally healthy leadership team. So that's going to be a good one as well. So we hope you'll join us then on October the 29th, and look for the invitation as it'll come your way. All right. So I'd like to close this in prayer this evening, and then bid you all adieu and a good night's rest, because you need it. Father God, thank you for this time together, for continuing to reinforce and maybe even find new permission to be human and what that means for us, and to take account of our neediness and our relational, the importance of our relational aspects of being human. And I just pray, Father, that that would be an encouragement and a starting point, that this conversation would be a catalyst for those who have watched to embrace this in a new way, to have further conversations around this, so that we can not only be good servants of you and of the people you've given us to lead, but also good stewards of our own souls and lives. So be with our brothers as they go on their way, and all of us, may we live as the scriptures call us, under your smile as we enter into tomorrow. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good to be with you all. Good night.